I'm Abbe Anderson, and I'm the CEO of the Brisbane North PHN. It's my very great pleasure to be here, and I'm very proud to be associated with these forums that we now have been running with the HHS for 5 years. So this is our fifth annual forum. I too would like to acknowledge the traditional owners of the land on which we're meeting and their elders, past, present, and emerging. And I'd like to thank all of you who have come and stayed through these sessions today. It's been a fascinating forum. I hope you feel the same. I'm only going to speak for a few minutes. I've actually been asked to give a very basic rundown of what PHNs do. I make the assumption most years that people who are coming along know a bit about PHNs and who we are and what we do. But I've also been alerted to the fact there are quite a few people who are engaging with us potentially for the first time, or who have engaged with us before but only with little parts of our organization or parts of what we do. So I'm going to try to give you a primer on what PHNs are and do. And this is one of those things that we talk about quite a lot at the PHN. How do we best describe who we are? How do we do that elevator pitch? And it's never particularly easy because of the breadth of things that we're involved in. So I'm going to try and touch on some of that in a very few minutes before I introduce our next and last speaker of today. So the nuts and bolts answer, which I've got up there at the moment, is that we are one of 31 federally funded primary health networks that were established in July of 2015. I've put the definition up on the slide that comes from the department's website of what their view of our objectives as a PHN are. Now, I've said there that we were established and have been around since 2015, but in fact, many of us, and in particular Brisbane North, has been around for a lot longer than that. Some of you may recall us as the Metro North Brisbane Medicare Local, which we were for 5 years prior to being the PHN. You might even remember us as the Division of General Practice that was established back in the early 1990s in this region. So to illustrate how long we've been around, I looked up what else was going on around the world, the important things in the year that we started. And some of those important things included, you know, the Pentium microprocessor being introduced that year by Intel. The World Wide Web was born at CERN that year. And most importantly, Dyson sold its first bagless cyclonic vacuum cleaner. But more specifically, who are we here at Brisbane North? Well, we are an independent company. We have a board of directors of seven members, many of whom have been here and still are here today. Along with many directors from the HHS. Thank you all for coming. We have, in our company, we have members who are organizations that have a leadership role in primary health care in this region, and we have 17 in our particular case at the moment, and if there are other organizations that would like to join as members, please feel free to contact me or contact us. We cover a geography that's identical to the Metro North HHS geographic catchment, and that's about 4,000 square kilometers. In our case, we have slightly fewer staff than the HHS. We have about 100 who are based in two offices in North Lakes and in Lutwyche. We have a lot of opportunities for community and clinicians to engage with us. I've only listed a very small number on that slide. There are lots of other ways. And I know many of you, I've seen it, many of our different engagement opportunities, especially around our planning and co-design, and whether it's mental health or aged care or disability services or whatever else. And so hopefully those of you who do like to engage with us know that those opportunities exist. What sort of activities do we do? So this is where we get to that elevator pitch being very difficult, because we cover a very broad range of activities. So I tried to distill it down. I didn't consult with any of the team members on this, so they'll all be going, where the heck did that come from? But we do things like offering support to primary care providers. And I say we offer support. It isn't always asked for or received. But we offer support to all the primary health care clinicians in the region, whether that be GPs or pharmacies or allied health, et cetera. We try to encourage integration between primary and acute care services. A lot of what we've talked about today falls into that basket. A lot of the work that we do together with the HHS is to try and make that more seamless system. We spend a lot of time on system innovation and redesign. Again, that's a lot of what the Health Alliance is all about, and you've participated in some of those processes, and that's not just the Alliance, that's much of the work that we do. Regional needs assessment and planning is now a very core part, and one of the parts where you probably engage with us the most. And that planning and needs assessment is all about trying to identify what are the priority areas and services that we then can commission. Notice I've put a little asterisk next to that word priority, because sometimes those priorities and our preference is that those priorities are based on local needs, but often we're handed national priorities by our funders in the Commonwealth, and therefore we implement those in our local region. All of those things, though, are underpinned by our belief in consumer and community engagement. And later I'll talk a tiny bit about our finances, but all of that work, which is kind of sums up the major bodies of work for the organization, all of that is done with about 25% of our funding. The rest of the money goes out the door into those commission services. Our vision is a community where good health is available for everyone, and we try and summarize that in these three goals that I've listed on that slide, which are about, at a high level, reorienting the health system to the community, achieving a health and community care system that is responsive to consumer needs. So we certainly recognize the primacy of consumers and carers in designing the best system to begin with. And then the third one is directing resources to best meet those needs that we've identified collectively with all of you in the community. And speaking of resources, so that's a bit of an idea of next year's budgeted income. The total that that pie graph represents for us is about $56 million for next year, which is, as you can see by that, about 50% of that is in mental health and alcohol and drug. So that comes to us in program streams from the government to be funded in those program areas. About, I don't know, roughly another quarter of that is in aged care. And then notice that little small slice on the right-hand side, the flexible including after hours. Out of our total budget, that's kind of the amount that we have that's at our disposal to figure out what to do with that's more, that's less tied to specific areas. And in terms of how we then spend that money, as I said before, the vast bulk of those funds go out the door to fund local services. And those are things that we've identified with all of you and the HHS as being those priority areas. And then less than a quarter of that is used for not just the overheads of the organization, but funding all of the staff and all of the other program costs that are involved with those other activities that I listed on that previous slide. So things around provider support or integration, system redesign, planning, all of those things. So although we have a lot more resources than we ever did as a Medicare local or a division of general practice, you can see that in relation to the need that's out there, we're kind of a bit of a drop in the bucket, really. However, that's where our key role as facilitators of processes like this come into place, where through our planning together with you and with the HHS, we're trying to come up with collectively agreed plans so that everybody's resources are going toward the same needs. And that collective impact approach, which you've no doubt heard us talk about before, we play that facilitator role or that backbone role to then see the impact be much bigger than what we could simply achieve using the funds that we have. And speaking of those having a bigger impact than we could do alone, I know earlier today you heard from Sean Drummond, my counterpart of the HHS, about a couple of the areas around the older person's plan and the children of Caboolture that are falling under the Alliance umbrella. And you've heard from Dawn earlier, and those of you who participated in the Connecting the System stream today, which I only caught the last part of, but that was a very powerful conversation, I think, and thanks, Dawn, for organizing and facilitating that. But I just want to touch on a couple of other aspects that we are falling, or that we've tasked the Alliance with trying to achieve. A couple of small things, really. The first of which I would describe as figuring out sustainability. And I told Nick Steele earlier that I'm going to give him a question on notice that he can possibly, if he chooses to, respond to later. But that is, we're trying to figure out this age-old problem of how do we embed in the system things that we've proven work really well. So how many times have we all trialed things, piloted something, gotten a bit of project funding or program funding that has an end date to it, and used that money to do something really good, and even had it evaluated and proved that it had an economic and other impact? And how many times, how many of you have ever seen one of those things stop when the funding stopped? And we just do it over and over and over and over again. And we've got quite a few of those sorts of things happening at the moment, really great initiatives that we've proven from time to time. But trying to figure out then how you embed that into the system is actually really difficult. And you know, what sort of criteria do funders need to determine that this is something that can become recurrent? And so for us, a lot of the work of the Alliance, and in particular, you know, I think about initiatives, not so much with the Alliance, but going out back to the late 1990s and early 2000s in this region, we were part of the coordinated care trials, where we had team care coordination nurses, who, by the way, are still in place, funded by the HHS. But we used care coordination nurses and working in the community, and were able to prove a reduction in inpatient costs of 26% in the intervention versus control groups, and really very strong results. Or right at the moment, we've been working, and the Alliance is using this particular example to work through this sustainability issue. We have a program with the HHS where it's about ED avoidance for particularly frequent attenders. Generally, this population we're looking at are homeless. They have lots of different social issues going on and are attending the ED very, very often. So we've been working with the HHS where they're funding a different model of care within the ED, and we're funding community partners to do a different model of care in the community. And again, we're seeing really fantastic results from that and significant reductions in ED attendance. But we're trying to figure out, well, what happens when that project funding ends? Do we just revert back to how it was before? No, well, hopefully not. Right, Nick? Yeah, good. The second thing that we're looking at with the Alliance, or the second foundational element, I suppose, that we've asked the Alliance to try and tackle is this issue of data sharing. So we're looking at, we're calling it the North Brisbane Health Information Initiative, and working with ourselves and the HHS and local GPs, particularly in the first instance in the catchment area of the Prince Charles Hospital, working with Queensland Health's Clinical Excellence Division to put in place a better information system, information sharing system, so that we can kind of de-silo all of the patient information that's out there. So there's lots of information out in the general practices about patients, lots of information in the hospital. Queensland Health has all that hospital and private hospital information. How do we join that up for the purposes of feeding information back to the decision makers, that being the clinicians involved in those clients' care, to better enable good decision making around those clients? And as a side benefit, those of us who look at whole of systems, being able to make decisions about best systems of care. So supporting sector knowledge, supporting quality improvement, but being driven very much at a clinician and patient level. So those two little jobs also sit on Don's to-do list, which he's promised to get done by a week and a half from now. So thanks, Don, that'll be good. So in addition to the significant body of work that we're undertaking in all of those areas, and in particular some of that very exciting work that we're doing under the Alliance umbrella with the HHS, in terms of our PHN, one of the things that's ahead for us is a continuation of our involvement in a couple of the bigger national trials, again. in our case, we're involved in the suicide prevention and the healthcare homes trials, and those have another year or two in some cases to run. We also we understand that we will be receiving some new funding, so in terms of any new funding coming our way, it will be mainly, as we understand, in the mental health space again, so in this case, psychosocial support, that essentially gradually replaces some of what we've been doing in the Partners in Recovery program, and that's all around assisting with the NDIS transition. I had hoped that by now I'd be able to tell you that we were going to have a much greater involvement in NDIS. We applied to be a local area coordinator together with a group of community partners. We weren't successful in that application, and we were sad about that on the one hand, relieved on the other, because it's such a huge body of work, and I do want to congratulate and take my hat off to Carers Queensland, who are now the local area coordinator for this region. They have a big body of work ahead of them, and we certainly stand at the ready to give them any help that we possibly can. In good news, the Commonwealth has decided to start funding us in 3-year rolling contracts, which technically probably doesn't mean a whole lot, but for us it means that there's more stability and continuity, hopefully, in our funding. which, if you're a service provider funded by us, that should mean that we don't have to get to places like the, what is today, 19th of June, without you having any assurance of your contracts beyond July, like we are right now. The government is trying to change that and get us on to three-year rolling contracts, so hopefully that'll be good for all of us. We have bipartisan support for PHNs, which is useful. Hopefully means we don't have to change our logos for another little while. There has, however, been recent, very significant staffing changes in the Federal Department of Health. The secretary, the deputy secretary, and the first assistant secretary, who are in charge of PHNs, are all new this year. And don't all have health backgrounds. So I don't know what implications that will have for us, but there will be some settling in time, one would assume. And just finally, last two things in terms of what's ahead for us. We are, now that the PHN network is a little bit more mature as a network, we are looking more in our commissioning practices at commissioning for outcomes. So that's about figuring out how are you going to measure your impact. And actually try and purchase that rather than purchasing activities, which is what we tend to have done in the past. So there's a lot of work going into that across the country for PHNs and trying to streamline our commissioning processes across PHNs a little bit better as well, so that those of you who have organizations that work across PHN boundaries, which is most of you, hopefully we'll have a little bit of an easier interface. I don't give any promises as to how quickly that will happen, but it's certainly being worked on. And as I say, better ways of measuring our impact, particularly from the point of view of what do consumers actually want? What does the patient actually want? What is the client's actual objective? So that's an area that we hope to be working on and figuring out over the next period of time.